There we go. Good afternoon, Rotarians and guests. Welcome to the Rotary Club of Toledo. Today we'll present another great meeting and a program with our Rotarian Karen Berman. But first, I'd like to invite Pat Sheehan to come up for a reflection, and then Trey Bauman will lead us in the pledge.
Let us pray. Dear God, creator and sustainer of all that is or will ever be, thank you for this day and all its blessings. We ask that you guide and direct our club, its leaders, and our actions. Grant that each of us may feel our responsibility to Rotary and our community. Open our hearts and minds to the message we will hear today about Toledo Early College. And thank you for blessing our community with Karen Berman and the advocacy work she provides to our local youth. Bless our fellowship today, and bless this food to the nourishment of our bodies. In your service, amen.
Thank you, Pat and Trey. As we begin our meeting, I'd like to thank and acknowledge USI Insurance as this month's sponsor. I was informed there are no visiting Rotarians today, and so we don't have any Rotarians in today. Oh, we do. If we do have a visiting Rotarian, would you please go to the mic and present him or her? Okay, Jay from Anchorage, Alaska, welcome. It's great to have you here. Corey Hyatt from Bowling Green Rotary. Thank you, Corey, for being here.
Tom and Betsy Brady, who have been very, very helpful in making what's happening today explain.
Welcome, Tom and Betsy. Pugh?
It's my pleasure to introduce Reverend Dr. Lisa Tucker Gray, my pastor and the new rector of Trinity Episcopal just a couple blocks away. Now, we have great expectations for Lisa. You may remember that she jumped off the side of the Toledo Edison building to help the Victory Center and rappelled down in her first week on the job. Excellent. She is a prospective Rotarian.
Welcome.
My guest is Lou Rosenblum, the Chief Operating Officer of Toledo Country Club, and he has already sent in his application.
Welcome, Lou. That's great.
Good morning. I wanted to introduce Chris Kelly. Chris is a prospective member with Croghan Colonial Bank. Thanks for being here, Chris.
Nice to have you here, Chris.
Good afternoon. I have two guests today. They're both from a company called Focus CFO. And my guests are Pete Gestalter and Fred Danhauser.
Welcome to you both. It's great to have you here.
Hi, I'm Katrina Hyatt, and I actually have two guests. Again, my brother Corey Hyatt, who's the president-elect of BG Rotary, and this is his first meeting at Downtown Rotary, so Corey. And then I have a guest, Daniel Gonzalez from Valencia Rotary, and I have the flag that I just brought back from there.
Oh, great. So. Wonderful. Thank you very much. So, of course, I said there were no visiting Rotarians. We probably have more today than any we've had, so. But we're glad to have you anyway. Now would be a great time to check into social media, let everyone know where you are, and then I urge you to turn off your cell phones for the remainder of the program and enjoy the gift of Rotary. Obviously, President Sharon is not here. She's down at the Uniendo Conference in Belize For those of you who aren't familiar with Uniendo, it's an annual conference of Central American Rotary Clubs, and they present projects to U.S. and Canadian Rotary Clubs and seek potential partnerships with those clubs for special projects down there, and we have participated in some of those in Honduras over the years. Kathy Tate, our executive director, is not here today because her flight was canceled because of fog yesterday, coming back from Florida visiting Carol Bintz. So Kathy will be here later this afternoon. Kathy and I and my wife Sherry had the pleasure of going to the Rotary Large Club Conference last week in Little Rock, Arkansas, and we were looking forward to some respite from the terrible weather here, and got exactly the same weather in Little Rock that we have here, including a half an inch of snow on a day when it didn't snow in Toledo. And down there it closes things down pretty readily. But we had a great meeting. 49 of the largest clubs in the U.S. and Canada were there, had 2 days of meetings, great conversations, had a dinner at the Clinton Library and Museum, which was really nice, spent a day, Martin Luther King Day, at Central High School in Little Rock, which was perhaps the seminal moment of desegregation in 1957 in the South, and one of the original Little Rock Nine happened to be at the school the day we were there to speak to us. It was a fantastic day. And then we ended it with a dinner at the Heifer International headquarters, also in Little Rock. So Little Rock's a great city. It's got a lot going for it, and it reminds me of the Renaissance we're experiencing here in Toledo. But we learned a lot from the Large Club Conference, definitely worthwhile. You also, you all had a surprise today with our new badges, and just a little explaining about that. They will actually save us going forward $10 a badge. They're only 50 cents. And they're more easily recognizable, easier to read the names. New members, 6 months and under, have red badges. That will help the rest of us recognize those members and make a special effort, please, to sit with and talk to those members and make them feel welcome. Those of us who have been here for a while have white badges. Past presidents have the yellow or gold badges. And President Sharon will be up here with a blue badge in a couple of weeks to designate that she is president. I'd now like to invite Brad Rubini to the podium to introduce new member Andy Fox.
It's a pleasure that I get to introduce Andy. He is the vice president of HCC Incorporated, a full-service coin company. Andy grew up in Georgia, and yes, the national championship was a heartbreaker for him. But he's been familiar with Toledo. As a, his dad worked for Owens Corning for 36 years, where he spent the first 25 of them trying to avoid Toledo. But eventually he could no longer avoid his fate, and the Fox family moved to Toledo in 2001. Andy graduated from Southview in 2004 and then headed straight south to Elon College in North Carolina. After college, he returned to Georgia and convinced his new wife and high school sweetheart to take a chance and move to Georgia. There, I might not have said that in proper order. His wife, Courtney, works for Sylvania Schools as a fifth grade teacher. They have a 2.5-year-old boy and a new baby girl that was born the day after Christmas. Some congratulations on that. When Andy is not working or with his family, he spends much of his time serving Elon as a past president for their young alumni council. Until this spring, then he'll get a break from that. He also serves as a marketing committee at the Ronald McDonald House. With his remaining free time, you can generally find him on the golf course at Toledo Country Club, out driving me by 20 yards, or cooking for family and friends, or cheering on his favorite sports teams, anybody in Chicago, the Cubs and the Bears. You're probably wondering how he got that from being in Georgia most of his life, but his parents were from Chicago, so they brainwashed him immediately, and he's brainwashing his kids. Andy's pet peeve is entitled sports fans. Everybody give a nice warm welcome to Andy, please.
Thank you.
Well, as it has been all year, it's a big year for new members, and I'd like to invite Laura Hanley to the podium to introduce new members Brian Hetty and Kent Sackman.
Good afternoon. I'm really excited to introduce two new members today. First off, we'll go with Brian. I had the pleasure of working with both Brian and Kent during my time at Concentric Group. Brian is the co-founder and CEO of Concentric Group, and he also calls himself a serial entrepreneur because he enjoys the challenge of taking a business from concept to reality, and this is something I witness quite often at Concentric Group. When Brian isn't creating new software applications or business concepts, he likes to travel with his family. That includes his wife, Amy, and his three children, Ian, Evelyn, and Lillian. And he also has a new golden doodle named Rudy that I was looking at pictures before the meeting started. He also likes to spend time improving his guitar chops, drinking fine wine, and riding his motorcycle. But he was sure to say that he doesn't ride the motorcycle after the wine. When asked what's one thing people don't know about him, Brian's response was that he is a sneakerhead. But anyone who has signed for his Zappos packages at Concentric already knew that one. The words Brian lives by include a few quotes. The first is, "Start where you are, use what you have, do what you can," by Arthur Ashe. "The secret to creativity is knowing how to hide your resources," by Albert Einstein. And, "If you don't know where you are going, you'll end up someplace else," by Yogi Berra. Outside of Rotary, Brian likes to donate his time and talent to both of his children's schools, and that's St. Joe's of Sylvania and St. Francis. And finally, in 10 years, Brian sees himself further expanding his agency's capabilities and buying another motorcycle. Please help me welcome Brian to Rotary. Now we have Kent Sackman. Kent is co-founder and president of Concentric Group. What he enjoys most about this is building successful client relationships through team-based and creative problem-solving and constantly evolving technologies. And all of those things do occur at Concentric Group. I can second that. When Kent isn't at the office, you can find him with his family. That includes his wife, Renee, and four children. You can also find him in the kitchen, outdoors, snapping nature photos, and attempting to land a fish or two. The words Kent lives by are, "The way out is through." He believes you have to keep working at it and that there is a solution. Outside of Rotary, Kent enjoys supporting the marketing efforts of local nonprofit groups, including Food for Thought and Leadership Toledo. Finally, in 10 years, Kent sees himself remaining engaged and promoting growth within his community and business ventures, and of course, within his family. Please help me welcoming Kent to Rotary.
This time I'd like to invite Kendra Smith to the floor mic to give an announcement about the Youth Service Supply Drive.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I just wanted to remind everybody that we have 1 week left in the Youth Services Committee supply drive. The list of wish list supplies of Read for Literacy should be in all of your past spoke issues as well as the website. I want to thank all of those that have donated thus far. Emily says that we have a nice collection growing up in the office. But just encourage everyone, even if just everyone in the room donated one item off the list, we'd be able to make a really significant donation to Read for Literacy. So if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to Emily or Kathy in the office or myself. And thank you for your donations.
Thank you, Kendra. Brent Kuzno is Johnny on the spot there with an announcement about the upcoming Under 40 membership event.
Thank you. Thank you, Dick. So, it's very appropriate that we have a new member, Andy Fox, at the front table because he jumped right in. He's part of this younger group that we've got going here, and he said, "I'll help," excuse me, "organize that next event," and he did. So, we have an event coming up on February 1st. 5:30 to 7:30. It's at Toledo Spirits. If you haven't been there, it's a new distillery owned by a local fellow named Andy Newby, and there's a little blurb about it. So we hope you join us, but importantly, this is really to target the under 40 group. We're trying to expand the awareness of the club. This is being promoted on social media. And so I want to, again, thank Andy for taking a leadership role with this, as well as Aubrey Hornsby. The two of them have really stepped up to that. Our last event was at the Heights. It was a great success, a lot of fun. Everyone's welcome, but please do bring somebody that's under 40. The other thing I wanted to mention is that of our goal for the year of 75 new members, we are at 28 as of this morning. So we're well on our way, but there's only more than 5 months left. So I think Zach and I are convinced this is extremely doable and appreciate the new members coming forth today. Also a stat is that in our under 40 group, we have 49 of our 427 members are under 40. So we've got plenty of room to swell the ranks of that group. And I would look forward to anybody joining us at our next committee meeting, which is February 5th at 1 p.m. after our meeting here. Thank you.
Thank you, Brent. Brent and Zach have been doing a tremendous job with membership, and it's great to see Andy jumping right in. It's really all about getting involved, and it's been great this year. This time, I'd like to invite John Davies to the podium to introduce today's speaker.
It is with considerable pride that I introduce today's speaker, Karen Berman. Karen Berman is truly committed to the education of young people. Currently, she is the principal of the Toledo Early College High School, at which she began her tenure in February of 2016. Previously, she had filled roles at Waite High School in management and in teaching. Karen has been married for 31 years and has a son in Washington, D.C. She is an avid gardener, a devoted family member, and has a close commitment to her two dogs, Karen Berman.
Thank you, Mr. Davies, for that very kind introduction. Fellow Rotarians, President-elect Wolf, thank you for having me this afternoon. I am here to speak about Toledo Early College, and it seems to be that Toledo Early College is perhaps one of the finest kept secret in Toledo, and my mission is to unlock that secret and make sure that every student in Northwest Ohio knows that we exist and what our purpose is and how we can serve them. Last spring, you heard from our superintendent, Dr. Durant, and he gave a very riveting speech about all of the things that are happening in Toledo Public Schools and all of the innovative processes and programs that we've put together. You also heard from my colleague around the corner, Dr. Gary Thompson, who is the principal of Toledo Technology Academy, and you heard all about their wonderful program. And you also heard about it from a young man named Thomas Perkins, who I had the pleasure of working with while the assistant principal at Waite High School. All of those stories exemplifies all of the amazing work that's being done in the city of Toledo and specifically in Toledo Public Schools. So it's my mission today, again, as I stated, to make sure that the entire city knows all about Toledo Early College. Starting the school year, we became a 7 through 12 academy in the district. Prior to the school year, we were a high school serving students in grades 9 through 10. However, understanding our mission and knowing that we have to do a better job of preparing our students incredibly early for both college and career, our superintendent made the decision along with our school board that we would add grades 7 and 8. And it's been an interesting year thus far. Toledo Early College, we service students all throughout Northwest Ohio. So although we are a Toledo public school, We are not bound by the boundaries of the city of Toledo. Currently, we have students who reside in the city, along with students who come from as far as Gibsonburg, Sylvania, Maumee, Springfield, and other surrounding communities. We admit students beginning, as I mentioned earlier, starting in grade 7, 8, and grade 9. Once our students enter the 10th grade, we no longer take new students into our school. Okay, so just a few fun facts about Toledo Early College. The Ohio Department of Education, for 3 years running, awarded the school the High Performing School of Honor. The state superintendent also awarded us the School of Promise, again, 3 years in a row. In 2016, the Fordham Institute acknowledged Toledo Early College as the eighth best urban high school in the state of Ohio. For 2017, we were ranked 24th in Ohio based on our students' academic achievement. In 2013 and 2016, the city of Toledo gave the school a resolution for our excellent academic rating. In 2016, Youth Leadership Toledo presented our students with the Bronze Students in Action Award. Last school year, our students worked really hard because they were not satisfied with a bronze award, and they were awarded the silver award. I've already heard them talking about what they're going to do for this coming year because they're shooting for gold. This past fall, our students, the Old Newsboys, awarded 10 scholarships for area students. Two of those students came from Toledo Early College. A brand new initiative for us, we worked with the University of Toledo's Honors College, and for the very first time, the university accepted six students into the Honors College. All six are from Toledo Early College. We have three seniors, two juniors, and a sophomore. Our National Honor Society only accepts students beginning in the 11th grade. Last school year, we had 60 of our 100-plus students in the National Honor Society. We had 36 of our juniors and seniors on the dean's list at the University of Toledo, and we had 32 scholar-athletes, meaning they earned a 3.0 or above. And this is a school that doesn't offer sports. So our students actually play sports all over the city. They are permitted to play for the high school that's closest to their home. So just a little bit about the founding of Toledo Early College. In the late 90s and the early 2000s, across the nation, we understood as educators and as community leaders that we had to do something differently with educating students. Bill and Melinda Gates, the foundation, in 2001, they presented $30 million, invested $30 million nationwide to begin what we call early colleges. So the fact that we're named Toledo Early College didn't happen by happenstance. It is absolutely by design. Knowledge Works worked with the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and they were awarded $1.2 million to create early colleges in the state of Ohio. Knowledge Works is a national organization that's committed to providing every learner with meaningful, personalized learning experiences that ensure success in college, career, and civic life. They provide educators and the tools to implement and sustain competency-based and early colleges to remove policy barriers that inhibit the growth of personalized learning and provide national thought leadership around the future of learning. So Toledo Early College was founded by Knowledge Works using those funds in those early years, and we have been sustained by the Toledo Public Schools. We continue to work with Knowledge Works as a school, and they continue to provide us with services by delivering innovative educational approaches and advancing aligned policies that are able to create, to activate and develop the capacities of communities and educators and to sustain vibrant learning ecosystems that allow each student to thrive. So every early college in the state of Ohio, and there are 20 plus early colleges in the state of Ohio, there are 13 in our Ohio Early Education Consortium. Every early college has to partner with a local college or university. Our partnership is with the University of Toledo. In 2005, former President Dr. Dan Johnson from the University of Toledo and Dr. Eugene Sanders, the former superintendent from Toledo Public Schools, collaborated and created what is now Toledo Early College.
A little too far. My apologies. Here we go. Okay.
Our school doesn't exist in isolation. Yes, we are part of Toledo Public Schools, but part of what makes our school function and part of what makes our school work is our governing board. Part of that support comes from Dr. Tom Brady, Mr. Davies, and numerous community agencies and individuals. We have a partnership with ProMedica. We have a representative from Partners in Education, obviously the University of Toledo, UAW, the Toledo Federation of Teachers, the Toledo Association of Administrative Personnel, and we have representatives from the Parent Association along with students. So what is an early college? As I mentioned, our name didn't come by happenstance. Early colleges, as I mentioned, created by Toledo, by Knowledge Works, are all committed to five core principles. The first core principle of an early college, we have to be committed to serving students from backgrounds that are underrepresented at the university level. So we look at enrolling students who are first-generation students, meaning their parents have not attained a bachelor's degree or above. We prioritize enrollment for students of low socioeconomic status, minority status, and students whose language, English, is their second language. The second core principle of all early colleges, we must partner with either a local university or a local college, and we have to sustain our work with our partners. Our third core principle, we have to work with our partners to create academic programs that enables all students to earn at minimum 1 and at most 2 years of college credit that is transferable. So our students are enrolled simultaneously as high school students as well as college students. Beginning this year, we have eighth graders this semester enrolled in our very first college course. That is pretty remarkable. Our fourth core principle of an early college, all early colleges must provide students a comprehensive support system that develops academic and social skills as well as behavioral and conditions necessary for college and college completion. So one of the things that I've learned along the way is that we have lots of students in Northwest Ohio, specifically in Toledo Public Schools, who are very capable, are extremely bright, and are ready or should be ready for college. Part of the problem that I see and that we see as educators is that they don't necessarily have the tools once they get to the university to actually complete that four-year degree, and especially complete that four-year degree in a timely manner. So one of our charges to Toledo Early College is to ensure that we have systems in place along the way, this year starting with 7th grade all the way through 12th grade, that will enable students to transfer seamlessly to either the University of Toledo or wherever they decide to go for college, and so that they have, again, all of the tools that will equip them to become college graduates. So what makes us different from a traditional high school? As I mentioned, our charge is to prepare students for college. I would always say to students or parents, when I worked in a traditional school, that I had 4 years to get students ready for college. In our school, we are preparing students simultaneously as they are enrolled in their university courses. So starting this year, the second semester for our eighth graders, we have what's called cohort classes. The classes are taught on our campus. The university instructors actually come to us because we don't put our little kids on the main campus unless they are in a situation where they're ready. So as an example, we have a ninth grader who came in and he's an incredibly brilliant math student. He took the math placement test and this semester he found his way, took the shuttle, and he's off on main campus taking his very first college math course. So our curriculum is designed to be accelerated. Our high school teachers actually prepare our students within 2 years, so they condense 4 years of college into 2 years and sometimes less for our students. Our curriculum is designed to be project-based. That's one of the things that we worked with KnowledgeWorks, and we continue to work with KnowledgeWorks, that we understand that for students to maximize their learning capability, that the work they do in the classroom needs to be meaningful, it needs to be hands-on, and it needs to stimulate them intellectually. So if you come into our school, you will see organized chaos. Our science department, you will see kids on the stairwell dropping eggs because they're working on their science project on their egg drops. In our social studies classes, you will see students engage in intensive research. I was pretty amazed this year as I watched our eighth graders take on some of the skills or some of the activities necessary to engage in some of those research projects. They are doing work that, honestly, seniors in high school in some traditional schools don't know how to do. As an example, they put together, we engaged them in what's called, and I'll share that with you in a bit later, the National History Day Project. And in order to get ready for that, at the very beginning of the year, they start with their research projects. They select their topics based on the national program for the year, and they delve right in. They start off with what we call a MLARC, is the Manual for Language Association Research Case Study. And from there, they learn research, and they learn more research than they ever want to know. But they do quite well at it, and they're quite proficient with the work that they do. So as I mentioned, that we focus, our high school teachers focus on the freshman and sophomore year curriculum. However, it's not uncommon to see our teachers pulling from the state standards from grades 11 and 12 to ensure that our students are prepared for what's beyond at the college level. So many of you may have heard of what's called College Credit Plus, CCP, is the old post-secondary options. What is the difference between Toledo Early College and College Credit Plus? College Credit Plus, students have the ability to take up to 30 hours of college work per year. Likewise, as I mentioned, our students have the ability to earn up to 2 years and more of college credit. So we're quite similar, but that's where the similarity stops. Our school is designed to continuously provide ongoing support services for our students. So for example, every day we have what's called our advisory period, and I'll show a little bit what we do during our advisory period, but all of that is beyond the work that our students do in the classroom, and it is to engage them and to get them again prepared behaviorally, socially, and otherwise ready for school. Once our students are on main campus, typically their junior year and the senior year, they have a schedule that looks like a typical college student. So some may start their morning at 8 o'clock, Monday, Wednesday, Friday. Some may start at 11, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday. And so their schedules are erratic and they're all over the place. But one of the things that, because of our design, that we have to ensure, our students must come back to us for several things on a weekly basis. They must come back for weekly check-ins. So we have teachers who have designated periods during the day who literally work with our students, and part of what they do is they have the students open up their syllabi from their various classes, they open up their blackboard, and we are constantly checking on their grades, checking on their progress, making sure that they're doing well. If they're not, we make sure that they have all of the support services either from our school or from the University of Toledo that they need to be successful. The other thing that our students must do, our juniors and seniors, they must attend advisory twice per week. Again, that's another one of those check in. How are you doing? How are things going? Are you doing well? If you're not doing well, what steps are you taking? And then again, providing those support services. Perhaps the most important thing we do is what we call Info Friday. And Info Friday for our juniors and seniors, they must come back for a 45-minute program. And during that time, we provide students with resources, guest speakers, everything to do with that preparation for college. Although they are in college, we want to make certain that when they graduate from us and they matriculate to their college of choice, that they know how to go about the process of being a college student. I remember as a 17-year-old, I stepped foot on the campus of the University of Toledo, and I remember having to find a payphone to call my brother and say, hey, I need to do whatever that was, because I really didn't know what that process was. Our students absolutely are ready, they are prepared, and they know precisely what's ahead of them. So, as I mentioned, what is the difference between College Credit Plus and Early College? All of those systems that I just talked about are not necessarily in place at a traditional school. All of the students in College Credit Plus are provided what's called a success coach at the university, or whether it's the University of Toledo or whatever their college of choice is. However, those students don't have to do those check-ins. They could go an entire semester without checking in with an adult to say, how are your grades? How are you doing? And those are some systems that we definitely have in place for our students. We also accelerate those students at their own pace. So, for example, as I mentioned, we have a young man who's in the ninth grade taking college mathematics. We have some students who are sophomores who are going to be taking college chemistry. And so we delve into data on a day-to-day basis. We look at individual students, their strengths. We look at what their needs are, and we then make decisions based on those individuals. As I mentioned, we're a very small school, and that is also by design. We have to be certain that we are looking at every single student, that we're touching every single student on a regular basis. So as I mentioned, our students have the opportunity to earn college credits while they're with us, and in fact, it is not a choice. If they don't have the ability to pass those college courses, unfortunately, they cannot stay with us. So in addition to the college credits that they earn, it is a very coordinated system. It is not just a random, I take an English course, I take a music course, I take something. Beginning with our junior class, our students have the ability to earn an associate's degree from the University of Toledo. First and foremost, they can earn an associate's degree in liberal arts. So for those 14-year-olds, 15-year-olds, 16-year-olds that don't know precisely what they want to do for the rest of their lives, they have the ability to take those beginning level courses that will transfer seamlessly to any state college or university in Ohio. We also have an associate's degree program in criminal justice, nursing, public health, the associates of arts, psychology, and health information management. So some other benefits for being a student at Toledo Early College. Toledo Public Schools and the state of Ohio have deemed it that because we are a public school, our students, their tuition is free of charge. They don't pay for textbooks, so that's the first thing. But because we are located on Scott Park campus and we have easy access to the University of Toledo, our students on a daily basis have the college, they are integrated into the University of Toledo and they gain that college experience firsthand. They have the ability to attend all the UT sporting events because they have their rocket cars. One of the things that we've done, because we don't have sports in our school and we understand that the high school experience is so critical for the emotional and social development of students, we have a plethora of clubs, organizations, and other after-school activities that our students can engage in. In fact, one of the things that we do on a regular basis, if our students see a need, if there's a void, if there's something that they're interested in, all they have to do is write a proposal, find a mentor for their organization, and they have a club. Last school year, we added 6 to 8 clubs. that our students were interested in, including the art club. We have working with the Toledo Blade for our school newspaper, and just a plethora of other activities that our students enjoy. So again, just a couple of things by numbers. We have 360 students, grades 7 through 12. We've had 8 graduating classes. Our graduation rate last school year was 97.4%, and that is pretty remarkable. We, in terms of our staff, we have 21 teachers. We have 6 support staff. So we are still small. However, we have the ability to ensure that we can touch each student and take care of each student on an individual basis. Some other things that make our school successful. We have small class sizes. Again, as I mentioned, we have a rigorous curriculum. We have that personalized attention, and we have a very family feel. Our students will tell you all the time as we engage with them, wow, this really doesn't quite feel like school. It feels more like an extension of their family. So just a couple of things beyond graduation requirements. As I mentioned, that as an early college, we have to do things a little bit differently to ensure that our students are not just successful high school students, but that they're also successful college students. So in the founding years, one of the things that our school decided to do was look at all of the attributes that make for strong college students. And we pulled that together in a package that we call Rocket Stages. And every student is required to complete Rocket Stages. That starts with 7th grade this year, summer reading program, and it goes all the way through 12th grade, that all of the students are required to participate in our comprehensive summer reading program. We require our students each semester to engage in service learning, so it's not just about them, but they actually have to go outside into the community and provide service, whether it's and it depends on what the students are interested in. But we have students literally all over Northwest Ohio providing service. Our students are required to attend cultural events, so we know that the students have to be well-rounded. They have the opportunity to attend events all throughout the city. We provide them with all kinds of information about the things that happens on the college campus, but again, that is a requirement. We also require them to continue with that academic pursuit of the love for reading. Good students read. Good students must read. And so they have to each semester, in addition to their coursework, continue that passion and that joy for reading. And then all of our students must also compile a portfolio before they leave us. Just a couple of things about our school. As I mentioned, we are on the Scott Park campus, and so our students, our juniors and seniors, and our few freshmen and few sophomores who do go to the University of Toledo for their classes, they actually take the shuttle all the way. It's a 5-minute ride back and forth to main campus. Our school's calendar mimics the University of Toledo, so we are not on the same calendar as the rest of the district. Our spring break will be coming up right along with the university, and our students have adapted to that quite well. So just a quick snap about our students. That's just a photograph of a few of them outside. As I mentioned, we have that family feel. What we tend to find is that families we service numerous siblings throughout the years. We have 100 plus students who are siblings, and then there's just a photograph of 3 of our young ladies. We have Hala, class of 2014, Tala, 2015. They were both the valedictorians of their class, and we have Diala, who's the class of 2018. We also have strong parental involvement. One of the things that we say to our parents, we ask for parents to give back 10 hours of service to our school, and we do that not to let it be a stress on our families, but we know that families partnering with educators make for great students. And so that's one of the things that our parents do. We make it easy. They can attend any of the programs held at our school. They can also engage with our students in things like the JDRF walk or a variety of other projects that we work with inside the city. Okay, here we go. So some enhancements to the curriculum. Some of our mainstays in our program, we have a partnership with ProMedica, and we have our science, technology, engineering, math, and medicine program. Each year, our students actually gain shadowing experience for their various career pathways through ProMedica. And one example is that we have our Girls Who Code program. We are the only school in Northwest Ohio with a Girls Who Code program trying to have young ladies gain a love for engineering and mathematics. Our humanities department, one of the mainstays of our humanities department, every student must engage in the National History Day project. 2 years ago, we had three students who went to the national competition in Washington, D.C., and every year we have at least 20-plus students who go to the state competition outside of Columbus. We have part of our English department is a Poetry Out Loud program. Our students work on their recitation skills, and in fact, we just had a young lady who qualified to move on to the regional competition coming up next month. Okay, so student activities. As I mentioned, we don't have sports. Our students, it's one of the things in our memorandum of understanding that we will not be one of those schools with the sports teams. So our students are all over the place. But we do try to make sure that our students have the ability to have that high school experience. So we have programs such as homecoming. We have a talent show right before we leave for winter break. We have an international festival, and this is perhaps the best day of the year. If you ever have a chance in May, please come on out to our campus to get a feel for what our student body is like. We have perhaps the most diverse school in the entire Northwest Ohio. We have students who hail from all parts of the world as immigrants, and students whose families come from all parts of the world, and we celebrate that every May by having what we call our international festival. We try to engage students in all of the activities on main campus. So as an example, we attend as a large school the President's Picnic held on main campus every year. As I mentioned earlier, that all of our students are required to do service projects. And just some examples, our youth-to-youth program several years ago during the Flint water crisis, our students came up with the idea of just collecting water to support that initiative. And as you can see, they collected over 7,500 bottles of water. We also, every year, raise funds for the Juvenile Diabetes Foundation, and we actually walk with that organization in the fall every year. We participate in Clean the Streams, and one of our teachers, Mr. Nissen, he is proud to say that we always have the most volunteers of any organization in the entire Northwest Ohio attend. We engage in Global Youth Service Day, and then we hold food drives throughout the year to support various food pantries and other organizations throughout the city. That is my presentation about Toledo Early College. My hope is that you've learned just a little bit more about what we do. We are an excellent school. We have excellent students. And I am proud to service the students in Northwestern Ohio. Thank you.
We have a couple minutes for questions for Karen, if anybody has one or two.
Number one, I think you folks need to do something about your brochure. Nowhere on it does it say TPS Proud, Toledo Public Schools. You really need that.
Thank you.
Because I think I know a lot about it, but I didn't. Anyway, okay. Secondly, the degrees here offered for an associate's degree
yes.
in nursing, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, that, I presume, is like what qualifies for you to take the RN exam. Is that correct?
That is correct. And so our juniors are the first group of students who will have the ability to earn that associate's degree.
Okay. So once they earn an associate's degree, they don't have to go on for a bachelor's. They can go immediately into the workforce.
Yes.
With a very good credentials, right?
Absolutely.
And does that hold true for some of the others as well? I mean, I'm familiar with nursing, but are there positions that people can get right out of an associate's program?
Yes. We do, however, encourage our students to go on and get their bachelor's degree. In fact, every year on a daily basis, our students come back from all over the country talking about their experiences in college. And as an example, we have a young lady who's at Johns Hopkins. She's 21 years old, and she's working on her PhD. But you're absolutely correct that many of these degree programs, the intent is that students can go on to the world of work, but they can also complete their bachelor's degree as well.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
Hello. Excuse me. Hello. My name is Louis Tehan, and I'm currently working to found the Rotaract Club at the University of Toledo. But most importantly, I am a Toledo Early College graduate in 2017. I didn't come up to ask a question. I actually just wanted to come up and give a tremendous thanks to both Ms. Berman and to Toledo Early College High School. This organization has opened so many doors for me in my life and given me opportunities that I never thought that I was capable of. Because of this organization, I've taken a leadership role in both my college and my community. And that's why I'd like to give my thanks. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
First of all, it was a great presentation. It's literally like a private school, and it appears to me you and staff are doing a great job.
Thank you.
My question is, if a student lives outside city of Toledo, what kind of tuition do they pay?
They don't.
They don't?
So as I mentioned in the presentation, we service students all throughout Northwest Ohio. We have students coming to us as far away as Gibsonburg. There are two cousins who come in every single day, and I think since I've been here at the school, they were absent once. So they're quite committed. As I mentioned also, we have students coming in from Sylvania, Maumee, all over Northwest Ohio, and Toledo Public Schools and the University of Toledo, they're committed to this process. So the district pays for their tuition, pays for books, pays for all of their fees, and any other expenditures that go along with attending our school.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome, sir.
I just had one quick question. I know in a lot of colleges they have 2+2 programs so that if you have an associate's degree, you can stack that on top of two more years of college to get your bachelor's degree. So would a lot of these degrees work that way, or does it just automatically migrate into a four-year type degree program? And I'm also going to say this real quick. As a member of City Council, it's nice to hear that Toledo has something to offer the suburbs instead of it always being the other way around. And I'm very, very proud to be a Toledo resident, and thank you for what you do.
You're welcome. To answer your question, the associate's degree pathway is not a terminal degree. So it lends itself naturally to students completing their four-year degree, their bachelor's degree. And as I mentioned earlier, it also gives them the opportunity to have credentials that they can actually go into the world of work. For many of our students, in fact, this school year, 52% of our students qualify for free and reduced lunch, which means that they are at the poverty level. So for many of our students, once they leave us, they have to figure out how to pay for the other 2 years. So going to the work is absolutely essential for them. I do also want to add that our students this year, we have students who have surpassed our expectations, and I just want to give a shout out to three kids. They not only met those 60 plus college credit hours, but we have students who've earned 73 college credit hours from their ninth grade through their 12th grade year, and that's pretty tremendous.
Time for one more question. Go ahead.
So I guess I'm motivated to make an editorial comment here. One of the issues with funding is that the state doesn't quite recognize these kinds of programs. And while students don't have to pay for it, the reality is if a kid comes from Sylvania, the $7,000 from Sylvania comes with him. And so there, frankly, is not a motivation by other school systems to utilize one of the best resources that we have here. So if I could ask anything, I think you need to keep working on our state legislators to figure out how to maximize the efficiency and resources that we have.
Thank you.
Thank you, Karen.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Karen, for today's great program and insight into Toledo Early College High School. To show our appreciation, the Toledo Rotary Club Foundation will make a donation to the Rotary International Polio Plus Fund in your name. Please join us next week when our speaker will be Steve Kiesling from Nature's Nursery. Immediately following today's program, we have four committee meetings: Community Service Committee in the Waynesfield Room, Disability Service Eagle Point Room, Youth Exchange Presque Isle Room, and Youth Service North Cape Room. Thank you, Brad and Laura, for giving the gift of Rotary and introducing new members. And Andy, Brian, and Kent, we look forward to your participation in Toledo Rotary. It's great to have you with us. I want to have a special thanks to Emily Clement. She did a lot on the fly over the last couple of days with Kathy not being able to be here. She made it a lot easier for me, and I appreciate that. And now to our resident humorist, Chuck Mann.
No pressure. I was asked to stop and pick up groceries on the way home one day last week, and so I decided to go to Churchill's. I did my shopping, went through the aisles, filled the cart, went up to the cashier and tried to put my card in the chip reader, and the chip reader wasn't working. So I gave it to her. She gave it back to me, and she said, strip down facing me. Well, I did just as she had instructed, and after the screaming finally subsided, I found out that she was referring to how I should position my credit card. I'm not allowed in Churchill's anymore.
You never disappoint, Chuck. We appreciate it. We are people of action. Let's go out and serve. Thank you. We are adjourned.